Hello, music lovers, and welcome back to the Woodshed. What does this with this. The answer is variations. Now, when we're learning to play guitar, a lot of times we are working from a memorizational standpoint on where do you put your fingers, and the tablature says this, so that means this is right, or the YouTube video says put it here, memorize that, that's how you play it. That's a great way to get started, but eventually you're going to hit a barrier. You're just going to hit a wall because you're just playing a game of memorization. You're just like, it's no different than playing a more complicated version of Guitar Hero the video game. You just have way more buttons, right? What's interesting about variations is how much it ties into improvisation. That is just taking a melody that is a fundamental core melody and adding ornaments and inflections to it to give it your own personality. So I want to take you through one of my favorite fiddle tunes from Bill Monroe and Kenny Baker. It's called Jerusalem Ridge. Get you all kinds of different players playing it, from Chris Thiele to Tony Rice, and talk about the variations that they're having and point them out for you so you can see what I'm talking about. Now, after that, I'm going to take a different approach and pick one tune by Yngwie Malmsteen, Far Beyond the Sun. And then I'm going to go through multiple versions of Yngwie himself playing this and point out that he doesn't even play it the same way twice. So it leads you to believe, well, what's the real version? What's the answer? And the real answer is all of them are the real version. All of them are the right answer. They all just have different ornaments and inflections. That way the listener gets something different, has new surprises every time they get a different version of their favorite songs. Sit back, hang out, and let's take a look at some variations. All right, let's dive in here with Jerusalem Ridge. What we're going to listen to first is what I consider the original version. It's Kenny Baker plays Bill Monroe. I remember my granddad having this record as a kid, and Kenny's on the cover looking like a stud with the concert posters behind him. So this is, to me, what I guess the neutral version, the natural main version would be. So here we go. So that's right. Right there is an interesting thing where he plays a double note that a lot of people do not do. I'm going to roll it back and just check it out. Right there. Yeah. A
little pull off right there, a little trill on the back right here. And there's actually three A's. I've never really paid that much attention to it. Check it out. There's three A's that he plays. Yeah. Okay, so now we're going to go to the Del McCurry Band. I love Jason's fiddle playing. I'd say, Jason, if you're watching this, love fiddle playing. I'm a big, big McCurry band fan. Like Ronnie, Robbie, Dell, the whole band is amazing. And, you know, we're so blessed to still have Dell with us singing these songs when, you know, so many legends and icons of the genre have already left us for the great jam in the sky, as they say. So here's Jason playing Jerusalem Ridge, and let's just catch some variations on that. Already, he does not do the double note that I was talking about, and he adds trills on the back. Double stop, there's different. Little trills are beautiful. That was cool, too, the way he went down and did like a little enclosure and then went back up for the tag. That was cool. So he's doing it like Kenny. Cool little double slide on that. All right, so now we jump over to Tony Rice playing Bill Monroe, and they play it fast, which is really, really cool. Tony, when I play it on guitar, I usually do like a low octave, then a high octave. I think it's so cool. You're going to hear in just 2 seconds, Tony plays it in a high octave the whole time. Let's check it out. So you can tell, I'm going to go back to the beginning of it. Listen for this. He plays up it and then back down, does not do the double note like Kenny does. And then on the second tag, he ascends even higher. So check it out. Oh, also, he has a walk-in where he descends down. Listen at the first couple of notes. He descends down and then comes back up. Right? There's a variation. A lot of variations in that. So when he goes down to the, he plays the three A's and then descends and then comes back. So some nice variation in that, which is really, really cool. I keep holding my hand up in front of the camera. Sorry. It's my first day. So now we've got Chris Thiele and Sarah Giraz. I'm probably mispronouncing her last name. She's fabulous. Amazing multi-instrumentalist. Amazing singer. Chris looks like he's playing some sort of maybe a tenor or a baritone. Yeah, it's tough to say. It kind of like an archtop looking thing. Let's check it out.
Hi from here.
So he's kind of almost got it like feeling like an Inspector Gadget kind of thing with some of the slides he's doing. So she's not doing the three note thing. Oh, beautiful. So what was really cool about her is she had a real slippery kind of vibe, amazing tone, real slippery on the slides and the delivery, and then a really slick trill pull-off kind of thing at the end. Ah, beautiful. Great stuff. Now, here is Tim O'Brien and Chris Thiele. This video is amazing. Go watch it. But Chris is about to just take the dog for a walk. He's on his home instrument now of mandolin. So let's see what he can do with this thing. Playing some variations. Cool flat five thing. Yeah. Oh, cool pedal tone. Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Wow. Let's get that one more time. This solo, at the beginning of it, he does a really cool flat five thing. Let's listen to it one more time together. There's a really cool, sneaky flat five thing and a lot of pedal tone stuff. Where we're going to get into Yngwie, and Yngwie is going to pedal tone your face off. So I like to see the overlap. Let's hear this ripping solo again. He really goes out on the second time. Oh, sorry. Let's try that one more time. Here we go. Here we go. Cool walk down there. Pedal tones. Oh, really cool triplets. Really cool triplets leading into that third section. All right. So you can see the variations in Jerusalem Ridge and just how it's a style of music in bluegrass where it's a living, breathing genre where it becomes a game of telephone in a sense. You guys know what I'm talking about, where one person says something, whispers it in one ear, and then by the end of the group, it's almost a different thing, but it's still close to the original, right? That's the way I see the interactions from player to player playing the same song in a bluegrass environment, where it's not like playing Chopin or Rachmaninoff, where you're trying to play the same exact thing every single time. They're all taking different turns and little different avenues to put little personalities on the main melody. And nobody plays it like Kenny. Literally not one person has played it like Kenny, which is extra cool. And nobody plays it like each other. So let's shift gears, and instead of taking a lot of different players playing the same song, let's take one player and play a song that he wrote. All right. As you can tell, we've got the mighty, the fury, Yngwie Malmsteen right here pulled up. And I've got it started with what I consider the main version of Far Beyond the Sun. And let's take a listen to it. One of the things I noticed is how much slower the super rapid fire licks are versus other versions where he plays. So let's take a look at what I consider the bass version, the core ingredients, if you will. Love it. Listen to how slow these are. Oh, that vibrato. That phrasing at the front of it is slower. It's slipperier. There's a pull-off at the top. What started all this was a guy commented on my Instagram post of me playing the tune. And I think I did the pull-off the second time, but not the first and third times. I can't remember. But I didn't play it the same way every time because I feel like that's the point of Yngwie, right, is to go, here's the show-off lick, right? He does that pull-off and walks it down, and it's slower. It's a lot slower. It's got a little more, dare I say, swing, if you will. Now I'm going to jump over to Yngwie with the Japanese Philharmonic. This is my favorite version. I can't say that, but let's just take a listen at this monster. Oh, I loved it. The the conductor's just looking at him like, what is happening? What is about to happen? It's awesome. Oh, he's pushing hard too on that tempo. Just lightning from the fingertips. That lick is so awesome. Just the way it's like, it's got a repeating little thing at the top before it unleashes down. Let's take a listen to the next one. Much faster. Pedal tones. Oh. Good Lord, that is just hot fire right there. And you can tell that he's like punches and then fast lick. Punches, fast lick, and that last little series of sweeps is just burning. Let's pull it back. Here we go. Buckle up. And it's also like he barely gets out of that series of sweeps that comes down. Really, really cool. So much more attitude. So much more attitude, and he only does two series of ascending arpeggios before just holding a high note. Just holding on to it. So different. Oh, it's twice as fast. So cool. Repeats it twice, different from the record. That lick is a little close to the record. It's sort of close. Okay, so now we're going to jump to a new version. This, I think, is... this might have been the version that I found that was the most recent. So let's check this out. Not even the same thing. Kind of comes in with a little more, like, pirate-sounding lick. I don't know what they call his shanties. With the sweep at the top to ascend up, and then he starts the single note lick. Completely different there. That's similar. Oh, that's cool. So that's very different. And notice the phrasing in this version. He's stalking the rhythm a little bit more. Skinner him, better na, better na. Just like it's got a little more, I don't know, just like it makes me think of like a jungle cat that's going to pounce on somebody. It's not as aggressive in your face. It's a little more stalking. Oh, no. I lost my spot. Let's go back. I love that lick. Jungle Hunter. Check this lick out. So that was really close to the record. Completely different idea there. And then more of a signature descent. Yeah. This version right here that we're about to watch is the instructional version. I think it's a Japanese instructional tape. I'm not 100% positive. But his tone right here is my favorite. It's my favorite Yngwie tone ever recorded. It's so just throaty and, oh, it's awesome. Check it out. So if you notice, the main thing in this version is it's like hold note, then some fire, then hold note, then some fire. Completely different from the record. Completely. There's that lick again. And notice he did three sweeps. Up. Whereas on the record, I think it's up. I think it's just two. You can proofread me if you want to. I'm sure somebody will comment on how wrong I am. It's great. Oh, no. Yet again. This thing keeps jumping. Here we go. And go. Holy cow, that lick is just a killer. Let's get that one more time. check this lick out. This is the opposite of the last verse. This is all killer, all jugular. It's like there's like some added stuff on the back, which is cool. Aggression. So that must be one of the things that we're catching. He loves to be like, all right, now's when I'm going to quote it. And that's one of those dissension. He's done that in almost every version. Yeah, he like went over the measure there. Oh, he's playing the bass note too before he plays the arpeggio. There's that signature lick. Oh, so let's end it out here with a very young version. This is like pirate version, bandleader coat. And let's just see what happens when young Yngwie. So keep in mind, this is probably really close to the time of the original album. Okay, that one's pretty close to the record. Again. But more sweeps there. That's different. Oh, yeah. Sassy band. The showman. He's not even playing the... Yeah, so when he was running across the stage, he wasn't even playing... Strage? When he was running across the stage, he wasn't even playing the Skinner now, Skinner now, Skinner now. He wasn't even doing that. There it is. Now he's back out of it. Who cares? Dancing. Oh, did Yngwie just lay out something that I would consider maybe Guthrie-esque or Vi-esque? So check it out. Yngwie is not one to tippity-tap on the fretboard as much as he picks and sweeps. I don't want to say he doesn't tap, just not as often. Not as prominent as, say, Steve Vai or Satriani. He just did a tap lick, tap dissension. Let's take a listen. Yeah! And the crowd goes crazy. And I love it too. So that's where we're out on the video. So let's just have a little wrap up here now as I shut this thing down. So in conclusion, when you hear a guy who wrote the stuff, right? He's not playing it note for note. He's putting little variations on it to give the listener, in my opinion, at least, to give the listener a different experience every time. I think Yngwie is in the mentality of if they wanted to hear the record, they would stay home and hear the record. And I think he's the type of guy that's like, dude, I'm going to give you something a little different every single time. That's how I like music. When I write my music, there's a million different versions of all my tunes floating around out there. Truth and Lie, I never play the same. I mean, none of them really. There's little signature hooks that I'll put in all of them. And in my opinion, they're like anchors for the song to remind the listener of like favorite moments, right? Like highlights, like, oh yeah, this is this, that's that. But in general, when I'm improvising through the solos, it's just like, I just want to give the listeners something different, you know? And I think it's really cool to see how Yngwie mutates the melodies and the licks. And I think it's awesome because it just prevents people from being like, oh, that's not the right way to play it. I'm just like, well, which one is the right way? Because the right way is going to be the one that you like the most. That's going to be your favorite version, right? For me, the playing on the Japanese Philharmonic thing is... I love that version, but I love the tone and the aggression from that instructional video with the white column, purple background. So I hope you guys enjoy this type of content. This is new for me to do something in this style where I'm not really playing, but I think variations are super important. They make music feel alive to me and keep things from preventing from being clinical. I know there's a lot of musical genres out there where the idea is to repeat or recreate as accurately to the composer as possible. And in those environments, I think of classical, you know, a lot of those composers aren't even alive. So it's like, yeah, we have to try to preserve the original vision. And in metal, a lot of times the idea is to be so clinical and so chopped and put together that it's the same thing every single time with no variations and nothing different. And that's the thing, which is awesome too. That's the great thing about music and art, is it's all just someone's opinion on what they might like. For me, I love to hear my favorite music with just little different turns and surprises. It just keeps me engaged and keeps me hanging on. If live performances don't have any improvisation or variation in it, I start checking out mentally. It's just like, well, cool. You're just kind of, I think to me, that thing happens more often in rock and metal. When I hear a guy just play the same exact thing every single time, it's not exciting. So that's my thoughts. Let me know in the comments what you think. If you're looking to know my tour schedule, or you maybe want to purchase lessons, bundles, tones, tablatures, all that stuff is at andywoodmusic.com with links to all of my music and my original content. If you're looking for more engaging lessons, more personal lessons, and things that can really help take your playing to the next level, please go over to patreon.com/andywoodmusic. There I've got hundreds of videos that are just lessons that are by request from patrons. You guys keep the channel going. On Wednesdays, we do a live Zoom masterclass, and it's a lot of Q&A, a lot of fun stuff. We talk tone, we talk chops, we talk what's happening in the music industry, and that's all, like I said, live. So jump over to patreon.com/andywoodmusic if you're looking to improve your picking, or hang out with us in those live masterclasses. They're a lot of fun. We'll see you guys real soon.